Dear friends and followers, welcome back to my channel for the follow-up video about my previous Concorde videos here at the Brooklyn's Museum of British Motorsport and Aviation History. In today's video, we'll be taking a closer look at the approach and landing phase of Concorde, the passengers who traveled with her, and what made Concorde so special from all other airliners. So let's get right to it for this final Concorde episode.
South 1383, runway 27, clear to take off. United 1538.
As the pilots reduced their descent speed below 270 knots and prepared for the instrument landing system, the pilot flying requested nose and visor down to 5 degrees.
The nose and visor down and 5, please.
Okay, the visor is going.
The visor or heat shield would then retract and slide into the nose cone and the entire nose tilted downwards by 5 degrees. Gradually reducing to the intermediate approach speed of 210 knots, the pilot flying selects 210 knots on the autothrottle window, whereafter the autothrottle system electrically adjusts the levers to the correct position to maintain the selected speed. And as you might not have known, Concorde had no flaps to reduce the airspeed, neither speed brakes. So speed was reduced by flying at a high angle of attack, creating a lot of drag with the delta wing, reducing the speed but maintaining the altitude required by a lot of thrust output. Once fully established on the instrument landing system, the approach speed was slowly reduced down to 190 knots, gear down at about 2,000 feet, and here comes another call out, ever so different from all other airliners. Now, in most airliners, the call is gear down, three green, meaning three lights next to the gear lever indicating the nose wheel and both main landing gears are fully down and locked. Concorde's call out is gear down, four green.
Have the gear down, please.
Speed's okay.
Four greens.
Okay, gear checks, four greens. Nose.
It's down a green.
Checks, brakes.
Check.
Where's the fourth gear? It's the little tail bumper wheel at the rear of the tail preventing the engine nacelle or tail strike in case of a high-pitched landing. And after the gear is down, the airspeed gets slower, again increasing the angle of attack, and again the nose blocks the view onto the runway. The pilot flying then again requests nose fully down, and the pilot monitoring sets the lever into the fully down position, moving the nose into 12.5 degrees tilted downwards position, giving a clear view onto the runway. At 800 feet, the pilot monitoring selects the touchdown speed of 158 knots to 160 knots. You would then adjust the pitch from 8 degrees to 11.5 degrees to slow down the aircraft reaching 500 feet as you were then fully stabilized with the right pitch attitude and speed for landing. The pilot monitoring would read out the radio altimeter to aid the pilot flying on his judgment when to break the descent rate and start the flare. On touchdown, Concorde would greet everyone with her famous delta wing swirl, and the pilot flying immediately applies full reverse thrust and the 8 rear buckets close together and force the engine output into the opposite direction, slowing down the aircraft. At the same time, you can see the elevons going into the fully down position as the pilot flying requests to put the stick fully forward to get some aerodynamical braking and to get the nose wheel down onto the runway. And as they exit the runway, the pilots cut the outer engines for fuel saving and retracted the nose up to into 5 degrees down position so it doesn't get damaged during taxi. And once they've reached the gate position, the nose and visor were put into the fully up position and the inner engines cut once the electrical ground power was connected. Okay, let's talk about a few more facts which made her so special. For instance, the inputs given on the yoke were converted into electrical signals, so Concorde was one of the first planes to have the fly-by-wire system. Where control inputs on the flight control column are converted into electrical signals and is then sent by wire to the flight control actuators mechanically moving the rudders. And she would also land all by herself, meaning she had an autoland system which came in handy when approaching London in dense fog. Please keep in mind, this plane was built in the 1960s, and all pilots agreed that she was so easy to fly, she handled so well. Just listen to the statement of Captain Norris.
We certainly all very much enjoy flying the aeroplane. We look upon it as being paid to enjoy ourselves, although don't tell British Airways that.
If that's no statement, I don't know what is. Half of the loaded fuel on the flight from London to New York was just used to get Concorde to Mach 2 and its respective altitude, which immediately tells you she uses less fuel during high-speed cruise than during takeoff and approach. And New Yorker ATC controllers knew that. New York was very proud to be the airport with the most Concorde movements in the world. So were the ATC controllers handling the Concorde's approach. And former Concorde pilots tell this story with a grin on their face. Once in a while, Concorde had to enter a holding near JFK due to a thunderstorm which just had to pull through, and therefore a lot of traffic was queuing up in the holding. And ATC knew that Concorde couldn't last very long in the holding due to the immense increase of fuel consumption at subsonic speeds. They then contacted Concorde and advised the pilots to switch to another radio frequency so they could communicate with the pilots on a private channel. They then gave the pilots direct approaches into JFK, jumping the queue of all other airliners in the holding so that Concorde wouldn't have to divert to another airport due to low fuel warnings. If other airliners would have found out about that, they would have been really pissed at Concorde, but a special plane like Concorde deserves a special treatment. Who flew with Concorde? Primarily business people who quickly had to cross the Atlantic to be there in person signing contracts or important meetings. World leaders and members of the royal family were very keen on traveling with Concorde, then because as soon as the red carpet was laid out, she made an outstanding appearance compared to her slow-flying colleagues parked around her. And naturally, celebrities who enjoyed the first-class service and privacy on board of Concorde. Only to mention a few regular Concorde flyers. Paul McCartney, Elton John, George Michael, Hugh Grant, Roger Moore, Michael Jackson, Phil Collins, and many, many more. British Airways pilots were lining up to get trained on Concorde. The entire type rating took up to 6 months, including 6 weeks of theory, 85 hours in the simulator, and takeoff and landing training for a few days at Shannon Airport. And boy, did they have a blast. It was like Boy Scouts going on an adventurous trip. They were so proud to be part of an elite group of pilots who had the Concorde rating in their license. And wherever Concorde showed up, there were always spectators waiting for her arrival, looking out for the white swan with its long neck, and try to get as close as possible to her on departure to feel and hear the roar of the four Rolls-Royce Olympus engines. The fans and supporters were very patriotic about it, as she was a national symbol, an icon, and a centerpiece of celebrations. She represented power and beauty and the courage of the people who made the not imaginable into the achievable through patience and hard work. Everyone involved was supporting and cheering for Concorde, as many installed parts were manufactured throughout the country. And what do I think of her? Besides the fact that she is the most beautiful airliner ever existed, it makes me sad that I'll never get to fly her. And if you listen to Jeremy Clarkson's comment on Concorde, I couldn't agree more.
We're not looking at Concorde as an example of outdated technology. It is still at the cutting edge. Losing it has been one giant leap backwards for mankind.
If you think of it, the plane was designed in the mid-1950s and kept up for half a century. The engineers working on Concorde were geniuses and thought ahead, especially from an aerodynamic point of view. The characteristics of the delta wing are amazing. And don't forget, at the time it was developed, there weren't any computers aiding the engineers. They spent countless hours in wind tunnel trying to get it right. And it shows that two countries which weren't best friends beforehand could work in such close relationship with each other and create such a marvelous piece of aviation history. And by the way, the company who built Concorde still exists, and holy cow, do they build nice airplanes. When I did the research for this video, I found out the disconnection sound of the autopilot and the hydraulic system of Concorde is marked in the same colors as on today's Airbus models. And that made me smile. I'm very thankful that my dear godfather, who used to work as an air traffic controller at London Radar, showed me Concorde for the first time. I remember it so clearly. I asked him, as I stood in front of his house, "Alistair, what's this roaring sound?" "Just wait, you'll see in a second." And suddenly Concorde came roaring over his house. That speedbird, Concorde 001, heading towards JFK. I'll never forget that sound and shape of that airplane when I first saw it. So thank you very much for your time. I hope I was able to bring you a little closer to an airplane which made aviation history. And a huge thank you for Brooklyn's Museum for inviting me to their site and giving me an exclusive tour around Delta Golf and their Concorde flight simulator. Wishing you all the best, your Captain Joe. 3, 2, 1, now. Okay, you guys, this is just a short side note. Before the video series with Concorde ends, I just wanted to let you know that recording and making a little documentary about Concorde was one of my life goals. I always wanted to do this. And this little book here is called the Joe's Affirmation and Visualization Book. I go through these pictures, there's a lot of pictures in here, on a daily basis. When I get up, I look at them and they sort of motivate me throughout the day. And one of them goals was actually to do the recordings with Concorde. So it set what I want to do, saying that I want to have the interview on the 10th of December at 6 p.m. I actually was able to do the video a little earlier. And the same goes with the recording with the Concorde in the background. I wanted to show that on the 1st of December at 8 p.m. I did that also in advance. And that just shows it, I was so pushing forward to get this done. I'm proud of myself actually that I made it happen. And I hope you enjoyed this series. And I'm sure there'll be more series coming up about historic airplanes. Maybe actually we should have a vote which airplane should be the next. I just like doing the research on these planes. It's just the story behind them is just so amazing. I'm hoping it's in your interest as well. So let's go from there.